It is finally time to pay our last respects
to one of Iowa's opening day attractions,
Poseidon's Fury, Escape from the Lost City.
This is episode 566 of the unofficial Universal Orlando podcast. Welcome everyone, you are standing in the Temple of Poseidon, believed to have been the center of ancient worship to the great god Poseidon. His high priest reigned for centuries here until catastrophe occurred. Welcome. I am Professor Malaby, leader of the GDG team on site here at the Temple of Poseidon. Our exploration to date has revealed an ancient chamber that we now believe is key to our study of what happened one fateful night some 3,000 years ago. As a visitor to this working site, you will witness the results of our efforts here.
Right this way, folks. Yes, that's it. Professor Malaby, hello. Everyone's arrived. Sir, we are just about ready for you. Hello? Okay, well, hi there. I'm Chris. I'm a volunteer working for Global Discovery Group, which means I don't get paid. Great, huh? Anyway, it seems like the professor is, he's not here. So, I can't say that I'm really as prepared as the professor, but I guess I can get things going and hopefully he'll be along any minute. Okay, so this is the UUOP's tribute to Poseidon's Fury at Islands of Adventure, which closed forever on May 10th of this year, 2023.
Thank you, Christopher. I am Michelle, another member of this GDG team, and this was the ceremonial chamber for the great god Poseidon until a trusted and evil high priest, Lord Darkanon, sealed the chamber and killed everyone inside as a sacrifice to the Dark One. There was a huge battle and no one survived, and this place has been sealed up ever since. And they say that the souls of the dead still haunt this place. Oh. The professor said there are secret hidden chambers throughout this place, but except for this one, no one's been able to find them.
Thank you, Michelle. Hi, my name's Mike, and I'm currently an apprentice here at the GDG as well, and as the team's other member is currently on an expedition to South Korea in search of other ancient temples. Anyway, as we were saying, just last night, the professor radioed us and said that he'd found a hidden message right here. And he was going to, like, show us his discovery today, and since then, strange things have been going on.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to our Poseidon's Fury tribute. I am, of course, Lee, and joining me to talk about this now extinct attraction are my co-hosts, Michelle.
Hi, hi.
And Chris.
What's up?
And, of course, joining us again from last week, replacing our good lady Tracy, is Mike. Hey, Mike.
Hi, how's it going?
It's good that you were chosen very specifically for this episode because Tracy wasn't here when I was looking for guest hosts, because you were an operations attendant at Poseidon's Fury, were you not?
I was, in fact. As long as I wasn't just volunteered to be like some kind of human sacrifice or something, I'm willing to admit that I may have worked there at some point.
That's so awesome. I love the fact that we've got like all these friends of the podcast who've worked the attractions. It's like our little team of people that we've collected over the years. But it's so cool. Like, I know, I don't know how you guys feel about it, Chris and Michelle, but I know when we started this podcast, and like the first 3 years, we delved a lot into the backstory of attractions and like the workings and stuff. And I was worried that going out to Universal for the first time after starting this, that it would change my view of the parks, that it would kind of spoil the magic a little bit. And what I actually found was it just made it so much better.
Yep, I agree.
100%. I become the annoying guy that's like, did you know this? Did you know that?
Totally.
Yep. You mean like me on Transformers going, look, this is the elevator section. If you look to the side, you can see where it is.
I'm quoting Mike's book to all of my friends throughout the line on the mummy. Like, did you know this is below us? How about this? Did you know about this curse? But you didn't know about it.
That makes me happy.
But it's true. It's so cool. Just those stories. And again, that those stories aren't out there. And that's why we do a lot of these things, because I want those stories out there. I want to hear them. And if I want to hear them, I'm sure there's other people out there want to hear them.
Surely.
And, you know, you look, this has been open for like, I mean, I know it closed during the pandemic and was closed for another 18 months after that. But if you take that out of it, it opened at 1999 when Islands of Adventure opened. So it's like 24 years ago. It's crazy.
That's a pretty good long run.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, you ready to dive in?
Yeah.
All right. So for those who don't know, Poseidon's Fury was a special effects walkthrough attraction located inside the Lost City section of the Lost Continent. The original 1999 version of the attraction had a different storyline to the one that closed on May 10th.
See, I didn't know that area of the Lost Continent had a specific name as well.
I didn't either.
Mike, mm-hmm. You worked it. Is that true?
Yeah, the Lost Continent had three different sections. You had the Lost City section, which was just Poseidon's Fury and Mythos. Then you had Sinbad's Village, which was, well, Sinbad's Village, as well as the Eighth Voyage of Sinbad. And then you had Merlinwood Plaza. Yeah. Which was the Marlin Oaks restaurant, also nicknamed the Stump, the Dueling Dragons roller coasters, and the Flying Unicorn, which came later on.
Interesting. Oh. Yeah, I knew about Merlinwood, but I didn't know the other two sections. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Cool. When the attraction opened with the park in 1999, it originally had a different storyline. In the first version, an old tour guide known as the Keeper wove a tale about the great lost city of Atlantis and an epic battle between Zeus and Poseidon. The Keeper led guests to the Temple of Poseidon, where the evil god appeared and welcomed guests to their new permanent home. The Keeper revealed himself to be Zeus in disguise, and after an effects-laden battle, defeated Poseidon before transporting guests back to the chamber in which the show had started. The battle used water projection screens, fire and water effects, and high-speed set-changing technology.
It's still cool in that end section when there's like that flash and then it opens up and there's like the whole room comes from nowhere and the same at the end. But it would have been so awesome to have seen that version of it. Mike, I know you saw it.
It was absolutely incredible. I actually got to see the show on opening day when Poseidon's Fury did not have a soft open like the rest of the park did. Triceratops Encounter and Dudley Do-Right did not join the rest of the park on soft open. Those actually did open on grand opening day. And okay. I got lucky enough to be able to skip school and go over and join the festivities. And so I was very eager to get into Poseidon because, well, I hadn't yet.
Yeah.
And that special effects show just blew me away with how state-of-the-art it was and the illusions they put into it. And just being in that finale transported back to scene two, the replica drop-down room was just a beautiful, beautiful effect. And as much as I enjoyed the reef refurbishment of it, there was nothing like getting that shock in the original version of this show.
Yeah, well, and especially it being 24 years ago when these types of special effects were kind of up and coming, I'm sure it had an even greater effect on people back then.
Absolutely. Yeah. Was it, Mike, did you send me a YouTube video of it the other day, or did I just come across it? I saw
the original show?
Like a making of kind of thing with like the, I can't remember. Was it you that sent me it? No, I'm guessing not then.
No, I didn't send you that one. I sent you a different YouTube video for the Halloween Horror Night thing.
Yeah, I came across one the other day. I don't know where it was. Maybe it was when I was doing the research for this episode then, of a YouTube video with like a couple of the original creative members sort of talking about the attraction, and it had some of the original like footage from that end scene in it. It looked weird.
Is it what, like that promo video when they're trying to sell you off the park back in like...
No, I think it was like an actual sort of 5-minute TV spot kind of talking about behind the scenes of the attraction. And like the original footage of the two characters was so weird.
Yeah, the CGI was not great back then, but it actually fit the bill a bit better than the live action stuff would later on. Because the live action stuff more looked like giants being projected. It felt more like you were watching a movie. Versus the CGI looked like these are actual characters in the environment you're in, despite the fact that, again, the CGI looked choppy,
horrible,
for lack of clunky.
Yeah.
It looked like an advanced version of an N64 game. So, but it was still extremely entertaining, and then the voice acting for it. We had Jeremy Irons playing Poseidon.
Nice.
I do not remember who was playing Zeus off the top of my head. I apologize for that. But, yeah, just that strong Jeremy Irons voice being Poseidon really gave a lot of oomph to the character and lot of oomph to the show.
Yeah. It kills me now that we've only been coming to the park since 2004, and you look at all the attractions that we never got to see, and it kills me. As a proper Universal nerd now, I'm like, I want to see everything.
Yeah.
You miss some good stuff and you miss some bad stuff. But that's besides the point.
It's true. I've seen some bad stuff.
I regret being so young that I just didn't care as much as I did now.
Yeah.
Because I did all these things. I was there, but, you know, just want to ride roller coasters.
Exactly. Yeah.
By the time I started going, let's see, in 2000, I was 15, when the 14 or 15 when the park first opened. And I got to go during soft open, during employee previews. I think the very first time I got to go to the Islands of Adventure was the second day of employee preview.
Nice.
My neighbor across the street took us in. Everything was shiny new. The paint was fresh. All the effects were new and up and running. And surprisingly, so I ran into very few technical glitches back then. I do have a fun anecdote about one of those, but it's an unrelated ride. But seeing Poseidon in its heyday for the original show was
I can imagine.
You can't beat that kind of experience.
Yeah. Yeah, because how often do you see an attraction get such an overhaul? It's rare, really. I suppose the closest that we've seen elsewhere would be like Earthquake into Disaster, and it didn't change that much, to be fair.
Yeah, it's gaining the live action, like all the live action scenes changed.
Yeah.
Aside from the let's do the three shots at the same time, that really didn't change that much. But the other scenes with adding Christopher Walken's iMotion technology moment, that's very different compared to the old Charlton Heston miniature layout.
True.
And then before that, the scene with all the casting, that was very similar to what it is.
Yeah.
You know, those two versions. But the changeover for Poseidon was very drastic. And the original Poseidon only ran for about a little over a year.
Wow.
Before they took it down to put in the Taylor version. It was a little under a year.
Okay.
It opened in May. I think it went back down also just before summer, because I don't remember it being open in summer 2001.
Okay.
Yeah. So the original version didn't last that long.
And no, which is strange, isn't it?
I've heard multiple stories about why. The most common thing was guests were not fully grasping what was being presented to them. They didn't understand fully that the Keeper character was Zeus in human form.
Okay.
They weren't grasping the fact that Zeus was turning into fire and was hovering around the stage at points. And they weren't clear on why Poseidon hated humans, despite the fact that it actually is a part of Greek mythology. But of course, a show like that, they weren't trying to particularly be accurate to Greek mythology, but a little accuracy was nice.
Yeah.
But long story short, what was there went over people's heads, and they had to make it more appealing to the mass audiences. So they rewrote the show.
And during that rewrite, that's also when they changed the rooms, right? Like where you end up in, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. The temple didn't change that much. They added a statue and some minor things changed here or there comparatively to the old show. The real big changes came to scene one, Chamber of Sacrifice, and scene two, the Chamber of Death. Chamber of Sacrifice didn't have the altar and all the artifacts spread out against the one wall. The portraits over the ceiling were all different. The Keeper's Hole was there, but the first rendition of Taylor's show, they weren't using that entrance into the show scene at all. There was a small stage, like a round stage, in the center of that room that got removed. The whole thing got recarpeted, and then scene two, it was a very simple room, so you had that raised audience step down area, and then the big cartouche door and the oracle or the talking jewel that was on top of the on top of the cartouche door. On the left and right sides in the old show were just pits of water, and those were the same behind you as well. So it was like four big pits of water that you were standing between. When the new show came through, the two pits of water in the front got filled in with concrete, and they added these steps and giant skeletons and all this treasure everywhere and covered everything in cobwebs and really did it up as its own show scene. But the point of the simplicity of the original show scene was to mimic the ending drop-down room. But they weren't going to keep that, so they could dress it up however they wanted. So they came up with this chamber of death, treasure chamber.
Such a shame. Can you imagine doing an attraction that you start off in a room, walk through another three or four rooms, and then somehow end up back at the room you started in? Would have blown your mind in 1999.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Absolutely.
It'd probably blow my mind now, to be honest.
I mean, that's probably fair.
You know, the fun thing was, back then, those were all practical effects. Yeah. Unlike today, where you've got a lot of, you know, projection mapping and emulsion technology and advanced animatronics, and a lot of digital effects that are used today didn't exist back then. Yeah. So the practical stuff is what you had to go with. And it really worked back then. And I would have, you know, I always wonder what that original show, if they had decided to create it today, what kind of technology would they put into that show today?
Interesting, yeah.
The closest thing I can think of is over at Hollywood Studios with Rise of the Resistance and their different showrooms and things and how they rotate crowds through them. Maddie has tried to explain the behind the scenes to me on how they rotate things, and you end up, like, you walk into the ship and you end up, you know, when the doors open, you're in a totally different room. I still can't figure it out.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Well, that one's a giant carousel that you're on, and there's multiple different ships that spin on a carousel.
Yeah.
And the show scene happens while you're spinning.
It's like Forbidden Journey. I still can't get my head around that whole carousel screen thing.
Yeah, right? That thing's weird.
It's crazy. That's why I'm not an engineer working for a theme park.
Yeah.
All right. Well, like Mike has been saying, so in 2001, due to guest reviews, Universal revised the attraction storyline. In the second version, guests would meet Taylor, a nerdy archaeologist who guided them through the attraction, albeit slightly different. Upon reaching the Lost City, the party is captured by Darkanon, a new evil godlike being. Fortunately, Poseidon, a benevolent god in this version, comes to the rescue thanks to Taylor's assistance and defeats Lord Darkanon. While the attraction's plot has changed, its arsenal of special effects had remained intact.
Darkanon looked terrible, didn't he? He looked like, I think I've said it before, we had a TV show over here, like a kids game show thing. It was like a VR kind of thing back in the sort of late 80s, early 90s called Nightmare. And it looked like a character from that. Like, it very much looked like a character from the late 90s.
You talking about the original or this one?
This one. Didn't age well. Like, we did Poseidon, I think we did it. Oh, we did it when we came over for the weekend. So we did it like December last year. And I was like, yeah, it's dated incredibly badly.
But the thing is like, I always said this because we would ride this at least once every other year or so. Like, we didn't ride it very often, but we always, like I've mentioned, I always ride just to keep it fresh in the brain.
Yeah.
So sometimes you'd ride it once a year, whatnot, but it aged out very fast. And honestly, I feel like just fixing that portion would have brought the ride up.
Agreed.
Like, it didn't take a lot. It didn't need a whole revamp.
No.
Just reshoot that, you know, ending portion.
Yeah, with new characters.
And I think you'd have, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And I think you'd have a you know, something that would last.
I agree.
Not timeless, but it would definitely be like one of those like Haunted Mansion type things where it's just, you know, it's this kind of niche style ride and people would ride it still.
Agreed.
If only it was a ride, Chris.
Attraction.
That's why Michelle doesn't do it.
Do you like the old tagline of ride it out from Twister when that was still a thing?
Yeah, that wasn't a ride either.
Oh, Lord.
Michael.
So once inside, guests walk through the same halls of the temple as they have since 1999, until they reach the first chamber. Present day, tour guests are introduced to Taylor, the nervously bumbling assistant of the recently disappeared Professor Baxter. Small talk and some cleverly timed gags break the ice between guests and their live guide while helping to establish a story at hand. But it is at this very same point that in the previous version of the attraction, a bearded, tunic-wearing man emerged from the side of the chamber to introduce himself as the Keeper, a follower of sorts of the gods, setting up the background for this unique experience.
See, I love Taylor in this attraction. Like, any team member that has a spiel, but they're allowed a little bit of leeway with it. So they started riffing on that once Potter came in, there was a lot of references to the Chamber of Secrets going on in that initial section, which was so cool.
Yeah, I love theme park comedy.
Oh yeah, without a doubt. And when they're allowed just to go off script a little bit, obviously you don't expect them to go off a ton, but it just changes it up different from every time you go through it and it not be the same show.
Yeah, is. Just like Horror Makeup Show.
Yeah,
one of the reasons I love it so much.
Agreed completely. Yeah, that is the prime example of it because they just, like, no two shows are the same.
Mike, is it so? Question on that, what Lee's talking about is there like an unwritten rule or maybe just an actual rule of how much flexibility that these actors have? I don't know if you know this information, but it'd be cool to.
From what I was privy to seeing the actors get their show notes, they are allowed a little bit of improv, but they do have to stick to the show beats.
Yes.
And they have to stick to the overall basic dialogue. There are certain times like, okay, there was a tailor that would make a joke after reading the hidden message. So like the lights go out, he reads the whole hidden message. His first reaction after that is, oh, wow. It's in English. And the audience would roar at that, but he got negative show notes of you can't pick apart the show you're in like that.
Wow.
You can't have that meta humor going.
I know from talking to team members who used to work Jaws, and I know it happened to Mike Aiello when he was a Jaws skipper. That's why he got taken off Jaws, because he would go off script so much. And apparently the leads for Jaws were very, very strict on sticking to that script.
Mm-hmm. Man, imagine how successful he would have been if he would have stuck to the script, you know?
Yeah, that's why they're like, you're really good. You can't do that, so we're going to pull you over here because we don't want to get rid of you because you're so good. But we want to use what you're doing on that to a better advantage elsewhere, basically.
Mm-hmm. With the spieling attractions, they would keep people on a tighter leash than they would keep the entertainment actors. But I guess it's one of those, if you were an actor and, you know, your show director pulls the leash, you're not going to get fired necessarily. Versus if you're a spieler and they really pull the leash, they don't stand much in the way of losing you.
Oh.
You know, of course, they could keep you on if they really find that you're a valuable team member. You're just breaking the rules every so often. But it behooves them to keep actors more so than keeping ride ops.
Okay.
So it's, you could find more improv because there are just so many ride ops doing the spiels that the supervisors can't be everywhere at once. But you would still find crackdown every so often. The tailors, however, they're watched, like the actors themselves are always watched kind of consistently as the shows go.
Okay.
Unless it's a very busy day.
Interesting.
Then the show coordinators and the stage managers can't get out as frequently to watch them.
Yeah.
But like from the times I would work at Sinbad, our coordinators or stage managers would be at every show. The directors would come out pretty frequently to give show notes, especially if there's a Sinbad or somebody that hadn't been up for a while, they'd be out there to watch them to make sure they're staying on script or just overall judge the quality of their performance.
Yeah.
And being an ops at Poseidon, I would see this kind of frequently. I'd say you'd see the show directors come out maybe once or twice a week, depending on who the actors were for the day.
And when you say show notes, you mean feedback or actual like notes on here's what you need to be doing?
Notes on here's what you need to be doing.
Okay.
Like, okay, you missed this, or your timing was late here. This joke didn't land. Change it to this. You need to change your delivery for this. Show notes can be a wide variety of things, but usually it's always to critique their performance.
It's crazy, isn't it? Because as a guest, you wouldn't know any of those things, and yet I suppose from a quality control point of view, it still needs to be kept on top of, I guess.
100%.
Yeah.
As a guest, you think these guys just do this all day.
Yeah.
Nobody's watching them. They're just doing their job and that's it.
Yeah.
But there's so much more in the background going on. It's really
crazy,
cool.
Isn't it? It is cool to find those stories, but then it gives you much more of appreciation, but you think it's like those actors who are performing those roles have to be so rigid in their performances a little bit, and I wonder if it takes the fun away from it partially. Do you know what I mean?
A lot of the, like, from what I spoke with when it came to the actors, they didn't like the whole Big Brother thing. So yeah, the microphone you're wearing feeds into the audio system of the room, but before it gets there, it has to go through the tech booth of the control room. And at any given point, the technician can isolate your microphone feed and play it in play it live inside the tech booth. So if the show coordinators or the directors wanted to, they could just sit in the tech booth and watch you on the security cameras and listen to your audio without ever having to come into the room. But a lot of the time, the stage managers or the directors will sneak their way in and hide in the back of the crowd, so they're not aware that they're being watched.
Wow.
And that's always to mixed reviews, because that's the best way to get quality control, to make sure that every guest is getting the best behavior versus, you know, I'm going to be on my best behavior because I know my director's here.
Yes. Yeah, so. Interesting. So much like the most recent show, the initial chamber was locked by a mischievous being, though back then the show's antagonist was Poseidon himself, whereas the closed version saw Poseidon as the hero and a new character, as we have mentioned, Lord 1990s Darkanon, as the villain. after present-day Taylor awakens Darkanon in the first chamber, guests are led into a second chamber where they are forced to retrieve Poseidon's trident or take his secrets to the grave as poisonous gas fills the room. Taylor picks up the trident, which awakens the goddess. The goddess aids the tourists by opening a passageway through the sea, bringing guests deeper into the mysterious temple.
Yes. Traveling through the infamous water vortex, after the spinning door is aligned and opened magically, guests arrive in another sealed chamber looking very much like the one they had just left. In the original version of the show, a sea nymph took the place of the goddess and spoke to the group via projection technology.
Interesting.
The sea nymph was, they called it the Oracle, or at least she called herself the Oracle.
Okay.
And it looked like a talking jewel, the way the projection worked, because it wasn't projected on a flat screen, it was projected on curved glass, like morphed glass.
After unlocking the door into the water vortex, guests would arrive directly into the main chamber where the climactic finale of both versions of the show takes place. Turning the order of the current show around, the chamber is immediately visible upon guests' arrival at the end of the water tunnel, whereas in the newer version, the reveal takes place with a bright flash and a fade-in moment in which a giant squid swims away from the sea base's windows.
Apparently, I think it was Brian I was talking to, that when they did it, one of the last times they did it, some kid got his phone out, went in the room, turned black and like shining his torch up so he could see what was going on. There's always someone, isn't there?
Yeah.
Guests. Ugh.
Yeah. If only we can have the park without guests. All right. The recently deceased show featured all of the same fire, water, and projection effects as the previous version, albeit in different order of presentation. Once inside the temple's main chamber, Taylor is confronted by Lord Darkanon, and it is revealed that Poseidon has been revived. A climactic battle ensues between the two gods, ending in Darkanon's fiery vanquishing. Rewinding to the beginning of this same Act 3, the Keeper is quickly confronted by the villainous serpentine Poseidon, and after a few words, it is revealed that the Keeper is actually the god Zeus, hiding in plain sight. While not as fleshed out of a battle as the recent iteration, a quick feud follows with Poseidon being blasted away into the background of Atlantis.
So hear me out. Can you imagine if they changed this to a Harry Potter attraction and had, you know, the Voldemort-Dumbledore battle in the Ministry of Magic at the end of the Order of the Phoenix? Would work so well in that chamber.
It would. I've thought that for a long time.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. With the rain screens and the way the projection move across them.
Yeah,
definitely.
It would be stunning.
I would even want 3D glasses. I want them.
I don't think Tracy would agree with you, but okay.
Both the most recent battle and the previous one trigger an explosive destruction of the Lost City, a backdrop of animation that was used between both versions of the show, with only the addition of the current show's Poseidon in front to differentiate. Previously, Zeus would hold back the destruction with enough time to transport the guests back into the chamber they were in before they passed through the water vortex. Not physically, but thematically, it is identical. In the recently closed version, it is Poseidon who performs this task, with guests emerging from a bright flash to black to see themselves back in the chamber that had disappeared before the main chamber room was revealed. In effect, the original show saw the main chamber transform just once, but the closed attraction sees it morph twice.
It is still cool, that end section, where you're like, you walk into that room first off, there's the flash black, and then the next time it's like this huge, massive room in front of you. It's still stunning, and then obviously to go the other way, but it would have been so cool to have seen that other iteration.
I think the drawback of the second version is seeing that effect twice. It gives the guests the opportunity to figure out how it was done.
That's a good point.
While still in the show.
Yeah.
The original version, they were walking through the entire end tunnel going, how did they do that? How did we wind up back there?
So I'm assuming in the original version then, Mike, you would walk into that big room like all open.
Yes.
And then the room drop would happen at the end.
Yeah, you'd walk into the temple. It would be the rain screen projections were all black. All the fish torches were on and the fountains were going, and it was just very dark and eerie. And then when the show would start would be when the giant squid opens its tentacles and reveals Atlantis.
Okay.
So that's how that scene would actually begin. Again, they changed that by just having the room start on the bottom and then go up and then come back down later.
Yeah.
I prefer the original way, but that's me.
I think they both have the merits, but yeah, it would have been cool to have seen that original version. I mean, we've talked about it, haven't we? It's like, it's kind of like you were with it, Chris. It's not something we did every time we came over. I think we did it in, I think I remember doing it in 2019 when we came up. It must be a weekender thing, because we did it for the first weekender, and then the next time we did it was the last weekender. And I can't even remember the time before that, but it's one of those, like, I'm so glad we did it in December. It's funny, because we were sat outside waiting to go in, and there was a family talking about, like, what is this? Should we go and do it? And we were like, oh, go and do it. It's pretty cool. And it, like, oh, what is it? And we were, like, trying to explain it to them, and they couldn't get their head round it at all. And we were like, just go and do it. I think it's worth going to see. But, like, the dad wanted to go and do it, and the kids and the mum weren't interested. So he was trying to convince them after we'd convinced him. And we were like, go and do it. You'll enjoy it. But if you don't like it, don't come and find us. So I don't know whether they ended up going. Go on.
The last time we had done it was probably, I want to say like maybe 2 months prior to it closing, just because we happened to be up there. And we were debating whether we're going to do it or not. And I'm not sure if they didn't announce the closure at this time. So whenever that lines up. But the reason why we did it is because anytime I see a group of Universal employees dressed in like nice clothing.
Yes.
With badges.
Yep.
I love just sitting around and just seeing if I can overhear something.
Yeah.
And there was a whole group of these Universal. I don't know what they were, but they're all wearing nice clothes. And they all have clipboards in their hands. So I look over to Lex and I go, we're going to ride this real quick and see if we can get, I don't know what group we're going to be in, but if I can get near them. And they disappeared once they got in there. So I'm sure they were doing something else. But yeah, that kind of forced us to ride it. And I'm glad we did, because it was the last time. We didn't make it back up after hearing about the closure. But yeah.
I'd echo back off of what Lee was saying. That had to be one of the banes of my existence working at Greeter, is trying to explain to everybody what the show was and having the explanation not land on anybody.
So it's difficult though, isn't it?
Yeah, people walk out. Is this a ride? No, it is a walkthrough special effects show, and the features lasers, fog effects, water effects, fire effects. And then, is it a ride?
But what is it?
It's a walkthrough special effects show. So it's a theater. You're going to walk through it.
You just got to say it's like nothing you've ever done.
Yeah, the closest thing. Have you done Halloween Horror Nights? Imagine a haunted house, but themed to Atlantis and three times as long.
Yep.
That's about the closest you're going to get.
The group immediately behind them would walk up, ask the same question.
Oh, my God. Ask them. Just do it.
Just go. Just go. Yeah. You're fine. You'll be fine. Are you? Can you handle strobes? Are you epileptic? No, you're fine. Go.
What gets me is why people... You're in a theme park. You're there, right? Why are you asking what it is? Just go and do it. Like, I would never walk up to any attraction in any theme park and ask the person at the front, what is this? I'd just go, this looks interesting. Let's go and do it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I could see where families with smaller children might have questions just to see if, you know, their kids are going to get scared or whatever.
You just drag them through it as well. And if they get traumatized, well, tough.
Oh, you're such a great father. Father of the year.
I know. That's why my kids...
Are they afraid of 1990s villains? Then don't go through here.
Yeah.
We would have a problem with families going through thinking their kids could handle it and then not being able to, and they'd leave mid-show. Like, just walk out the emergency exit mid-show, flood the room with daylight because there's no buffer between the outside and the inside in those rooms.
Yikes.
Every single day.
Yeah. Again, it is a shame that it's gone, but it's, you can understand, it's very much of its time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there is nothing like that anywhere. Honestly, I don't think I've ever been through anything like it ever.
No,
I am sad that it's gone. However, it was dated. It's been in operation for 23, almost 24 years.
Yeah.
At this point, 24 years. It's been open for 24 years, and it's, again, as I said earlier, nothing gold can stay. Everything's got an expiration date. Sooner or later, our favorite things will close, and I've experienced this multiple times. But Poseidon always had a special place in my heart because it was the very first job I ever had. Yeah. And I was sad to see the original iteration change over to Taylor, and then I'm doubly so sad to see it close now and see so many of my friends have to say goodbye to the roles they loved.
Yeah. I think if you were ever going to look at, if they were ever going to expand Islands of Adventure, I think there's two lands that were always on the chopping block. And one of them doesn't seem like it's going anywhere, Toon Lagoon, I'm looking at you. but it's like, I think when Hogsmeade opened, everyone kind of expected Hogsmeade to eat into, which it did, it ate into Merlinwood and then expected it just to branch out into the rest of it anyway at some point. So I think the writing's been on the wall for the Lost Continent for the longest time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also, you know, the other thing about the Lost Continent, and particularly this ride, is the footprint that this building and front facade have.
Yeah, it's like, huge.
It's, one could say it's a lot of wasted land that you could be using for something, but then the flip side of that argument is that's the art of it, right? That's like the grandioseness of seeing, you know, the statue there and everything. It's the intrigue of wanting to go ride that. So it's, you don't see a lot of that anymore because everything has to be used to its maximum amount of, you know, this amount of land. We got to use, you know, this amount of stuff in there. Yeah,
maximizing the space you're using for the attraction itself. Like, you would never see a singular attraction with such a lavish, huge open entryway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's, a lot of the theme parks used to have that kind of big set piece that you could just go and enjoy. But now all those set pieces have to be practical because space is a commodity now.
Yeah.
And Universal has kind of caught up to that point where it has become increasingly more valuable for them.
Yeah.
The Islands of Adventure was made at a time for them where the coffers were full. Pretty much when they went into Isle of Adventure. Sure, things got cut here or there for various reasons. Budgetary restrictions set in during the construction phase. They always do. But when they were designing Isles of Adventure, it was the pie in the sky park for them.
Yeah.
And so they could have these giant set pieces that didn't have to be practical, that could just be enjoyed. And it wasn't so much just the money as it was the space. I don't think they had the foresight back in the 90s to see how much they would need to expand, but not only that, how much the area around them would expand.
Yeah.
Because Universal owns so much land around the park. And during the collapse, the economic collapse of, 2003, that era, when we hit the first big recession, post 9/11, they sold off so much acreage around them that all got developed into communities. I mean, I live in a neighborhood that's less than a mile away from the back of the park. And just to see my neighborhood explode the way it has, with shops and golf courses and tennis courts and all, you name it, it's been developed in the area now. in that short span of time that Universal sold off that land. So nowadays, I think they're looking at that as it's not so much a mistake of the past as much as they have to have the foresight of when they build Epic Universe, they're not going to have the ability to do too many of those set pieces anymore.
Yeah.
Because they know their land is restricted.
But then I think they've learned over that. I think we've talked about it for years now. They've learned how well and how economically Universal uses space now. So my two prime examples are the Hollywood Drive and mini golf. The space they use for that, the fact that there's two 18-hole mini golf courses underneath the moving walkway in an area that wasn't really ever used for anything before is amazing. And then Volcano Bay, it feels like that is huge, and yet it's on such a small plot of land, is amazing to me.
Universal, definitely, they know how to do that. They just work it into these, like, just here's your little plot of land, we can build it up.
Yeah.
And Volcano Bay has some really good set pieces in it that they have made practical.
Yeah.
So every square inch is used, but you still get the grand beauty of it like you would the front of Poseidon. Oh, and incidentally, do you know that Poseidon, the very front of it, that was supposed to have a little wading pond? There's a walkway that was built to it, and families were supposed to be able to go down, you know, let your kids play in the water, splash in the water, and soak your feet.
Is that the part that's roped off?
Yep.
And I always wondered what that was.
Yep, that was supposed to be a little waiting pond for families and kids and stuff. The problem was, to have that there, it was deep enough where they would have to have a lifeguard on staff.
Wow.
And they're like, we don't want to pay to have a lifeguard standing here watching kids do this.
No.
So rope it off. We're done.
Wow.
Wow.
I'd love to see what a lifeguard themed to that man would look like.
Yeah.
Poseidon himself.
Poseidon's out there. Yeah. The old the keeper.
That adds a little bit of practicality to that big set piece, but not much practicality.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
So it was never used at all, right?
Nope. It was just decorative at that point after they found out they had to have a lifeguard on duty.
That's a bummer.
Interesting. Cool. Well, before we move on, of course, she might not be here, but she wanted to chime in with her thoughts. So I will pass you over to our other operative of the GDG out in South Korea, and that is Tracy.
Hi, it's just Tracy here. I just wanted to chime in with a few words on Poseidon's Fury and its closure. And for many of us, it's been part of our lives for as long as we've been going. We've certainly been... We can't really say riding it, can you? Experiencing it since we started going in 2004, we've seen it have closures, temporary ones, obviously at the time. But it was always something that we enjoyed. We definitely appreciated the facade. The outside portion is absolutely stunning, and it's very photogenic. And you all know I love my photos. Yeah, it was always one of those places where. I mean, I wouldn't say you go for a rest because you are walking and standing a lot. And for some of us, that's quite tiring. And yes, the film
Thank you, Tracy.
Was dated, and it was always dated the entire time we were going. But it was still fun. It was a bit of a romp. And the water vortex tunnel, I mean, wow. I've never seen anything like it, and I don't think we'll see anything like it again. It's a shame that we're going to lose that. That's the bit I'm going to miss the most out of all of it. You know, having your first room with your little guide, whose name eludes me at the moment, that's always Taylor. Fun because it's quite tongue-in-cheek and, you know, just it's classic theme park scripting and, you know, just a bit of audience participation. That's always fun, and it's just one of those rides I will miss, even though I didn't always want to ride. I keep saying right, I always want to do it because of the amount of standing.
Yeah.
And I know that Lee really loved it, but I will miss it. I have some very fond memories of it, but I am quite excited to see what is going to come next, especially seeing as I've been banging around Zelda for some time, and now it looks like that's what we're getting. So I am quite excited for that. And bring on Zelda.
I can't decide whether she's being facetious when she says she knows I really love it. Like, I don't know whether she means that or whether she's like sarcastically, oh, no, Lee really loved it. Because I did for the longest time actually really love it. But
that'll be the great mystery, Lee.
Yes. Right. Cool. We shall take a quick break and we'll be back with a very special guest. So it's over to our sponsors.
Man, we need a vacation.
Oh, I got this.
Whoa, that's awesome. But I was thinking something a little more adventurous.
Okay, how about this?
Yes!
Woo! And how about some relaxation for Obama?
Oh, perfect. How did you do that?
Easy. Portkey Vacations.
For your next vacation, let Portkey Vacations take away all the guesswork and stress of planning. From air and hotel to theme park tickets and everything else in between, they've got you covered. Just visit PortkeyVacations.com and touch the Portkey to get started with your free, no-obligation quote request. With just one touch, and Portkey Vacations will magically take you wherever you want to go.
Everyone, welcome back. We are here, of course, talking about Poseidon's Fury, and we are very honoured to be joined by former project manager for the attraction itself, Poseidon's Fury, Mr. Tony Hansen. Tony, thank you so much for taking the time to come and speak to us.
Oh, thank you. I'm very excited to share my knowledge.
That's good. Like you've said when before we started recording, it's been 20 years since you've worked at Universal. I hope the brain, the memory still are better than mine is at this point, to be fair, because I can't remember what I did yesterday, let alone 20 years ago.
I'll do my best. I actually cheated a little bit, pulled out some of my own notes and drawings. So I tried to refresh.
Awesome.
Sweet. Yep. So, Tony, for our listeners, could you give us a brief history of how you got into this line of work and how you came to be involved with this at Universal?
Oh, wow. That's a dangerous one. Brief. All right. So back in the mid-80s, my mother took me on a vacation when I was in high school, and I ended up riding the Horizons attraction at Epcot. And she and I went back to Disney Village Marketplace to Donald's Dairy Dip, which was the ice cream stand, which is roughly now where the Lego store is. And I looked at her and said, I want to be the lighting designer for Disney. So
wow.
Thinking at that time that that was only one person. Went back, finished up high school, spent a little bit of time in Minnesota in the theater market, went to college for lighting, et cetera, did a lot of that. Met my now wife, and in 94, when we were living in Duluth, Minnesota, in the armpit of North America, a little old lady a few doors down from us, to put it bluntly, froze to death going to get her mail.
Oh.
And I decided this was a ridiculous climate to live in, so I looked at my then-fiancé and said, I'm moving to Florida this summer, you want to go? And she looked at me and kind of laughed. I said, nope, I'm moving to Florida. And so I did. Not much of anything. She and I got married quickly and moved on down here and didn't start with much. And luckily, Universal was kind enough to pick me up for the 1994 season of Halloween Horror Nights.
Nice.
And
I worked on that and was a lighting designer for that. And had the great chance to work with Beetlejuice's The Price is Fright show.
Awesome.
That propelled me into working full-time with entertainment. I was then moved over to the ride and show department in the film department, which meant I got to work with all of the everything from Back to the Future to E.T. and Kong, all have projectors in them. And as new attractions were coming on, I had the opportunity to work with them. So T2 3D, Twister, all had various film. That led me over to the Spider-Man attraction. I moved over to creative for that. I worked on Spider-Man, helped open that one up to the public, jumped over to Men in Black, worked as a project manager there, then jumped back to redo Poseidon's Fury, which is what we're talking about. That was the end of my Universal career. From that point, I went to the company I'm at now, Technolux Lighting, and I am the principal lighting designer here for the last 20 years.
That's a hell of a journey.
Yeah,
it is.
That's the brief version.
Yeah, you've fundamentally had your hands on a lot of the major attractions at Universal over the years.
At least pieces and parts of it, and I've been very fortunate since then to work on attractions around the world with other companies, so I'm still very active in themed entertainment.
So awesome.
That is cool. And I love how there's a splash of Horror Nights in there as well.
Oh, without a doubt.
We're all
big fans.
The Fright is Right comes up quite often in our sister podcast conversations because we think it needs to be brought back.
Yes.
So we might have to have you on Rush of Fear too. Just saying.
I love Crisis Fright, and I actually play Beetlejuice character myself. So it has a nice soft spot. So yes, I would love to see Crisis Fright come back.
So cool.
All right, Tony, can you tell us what was the remit for the changing over of the old Poseidon to the new version?
Well, there's a whole lot of stories about that. Some of the insider stories suggested that the guests were confused by the old Poseidon. It was an amazing effect. And there were some discussions that it was confusing guests or even scaring them. The magic came out that we were going to fly the room more than once, and also to make it more accessible to the masses. There was an inside joke at the time. I'm going to have to steal from other IPs, but at one point we were calling it Darth Maul versus Santa Claus. if you look at it, we had gone out into the park to try to get public opinion of what was popular at the time. And if you go back, you're going to find out it was Darth Maul and little girls like Santa Claus. So that was a big part of the drive. But it was to make it more accessible, more interesting. It had a problem in the beginning, a lot like I believe the original Ghostbusters attraction did, where guests didn't realize they were actually watching a show. A lot of people thought they were watching a movie.
Okay.
So, yeah, the plan was to just revamp it and let's get a new story in there, which is what brought up the storyline and brought up Taylor and made it all more like certain adventure movies you'd see now and things like that.
Because it's interesting, isn't it? Because it's called Poseidon's Fury, yet the title doesn't really fit the attraction storyline for when it closed.
No, it did not. It became a whole lot more about Taylor than I think we all thought it was going into it.
Which is cool. It's like one of the things that I lament a lot now that you don't see in theme parks much are those actor-driven attractions. And Poseidon was, I think we talked about it on the show when it was closed. I think it was the last one at Universal. Like, that's not an actual sit-down show. I think it's the last vestige of that sort of, like, Jaws and... Poseidon, like even T2 3D to a certain extent, of those attractions that had like a live team member as part of the show itself.
I mean, you still have it, but you mentioned that the caveat not sit down because Horror Makeup is still there, which is an opening day show, and of course, Born Spectacular. But as an attraction, there used to be the Spielers on Jaws and Kong and everything else had a different interaction to it. When Kong originally opened, there were even live people walking down in the streets of the attraction.
Wow, I love hearing stories like that because it just, can you imagine how much more fleshed out an attraction is because it would feel so much more real.
It always felt weird not having people there.
I guess Fast and the Furious has that pre-show and so does Men in Black.
Yeah, they do. It's all there, but bit by bit, people have been removed from pretty much everything. Even Men in Black used to have people occasionally walk through down in the lobby. And they haven't done that in forever that I know of.
Yeah, because I heard stories, I don't know how true it was, that when that first opened, that used to be the team members' break room.
Yes.
Yeah, that's so like it was the perfect reason. But then I think as a team member, when guests are looking at you all the time, you kind of get a bit annoyed.
It was a curious idea, and I understand why it went away. But yes, I always like the thought of people interacting.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, you can still go down there if you go ask the greeters for something very specific. It's like a password. I don't want to give it away on the show because I don't want to flood them with requests. But
no, there are ways to get. It's true. It's true. But it's not. It's not as common to see people down there as it would have been.
It used to be for a long time where you could just ask a team member. I remember Seth was telling us, Seth Kaberski told us a couple of weeks ago that apparently it's the only one they've taken away now, and that he was told by a team member that if you want to go down there, you've got to basically go and lobby guest services to bring it back.
It wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, which is such a shame because it's awesome down there. I love it. Anyway, that's not Poseidon's Fury. I could talk about Men in Black all day long, but that's not why we're here.
So, if I may ask, in your job as project manager, what were the things you were overseeing?
So, originally I was brought in to work with the gas flame effects and a little bit with the lighting and with the film, with my background in film, and being one of the projectionists. As any project moves along, things finish up and other people start falling off. That's the normal progression of any project. And it turned out that I was the last creative development team member there. So by the end of it, I was the overall project manager for the entire attraction.
Wow. But
my goal going in would have been the films and the gas flame effects that were added into the water area.
Because they are, like, it's still, even on the last day, that whole water projection with the fire effects and stuff, it's still so cool. You don't see that in attractions much anymore. And it's, again, another thing that's slowly being eked away because, yeah, gas costs a lot of money nowadays.
It does, and I guarantee you that gas effect was not inexpensive. The entire building was an incredibly unique, very expensive building to build. Back when it was originally developed for the original Islands of Adventure, that building is a phenomenal structure. When you're in there, you have no idea how much is below you, and that's unusual in Florida.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is below me? Now I have to know.
So the entire pond, which is what we would call the area of the main showroom, the entire pond can be drained into the basement. The pond and then some can be drained into the basement. There's a huge aquifer, man-made aquifer, in the basement of the building right underneath the water vortex.
Wow.
And it is possible to isolate either the show pond or the vortex separate from each other and run one without the other. Matter of fact, they can't run at full force at the same time. And the building, the pond, when I needed to, I could drain into the basement in less than 15 minutes.
Wow.
And we could refill it just as quickly. There are six enormous pumps in the basement that are what drive the famous vortex effect and then also drive all of the water effects out in the main show scene. And all of that infrastructure for the pumps and for the sprays and all the fountains and some of the gas effects and all that are underneath in that building.
Wow. And you said
that would be cool to see.
You said you couldn't run those two at the same time. So is it a timing thing when you're running a certain set of guests?
It is the immense amount of water pressure that is needed to do that vortex effect.
Wow. Okay.
The vortex is obviously a very, very famous effect.
Yes.
It's simple in and of itself. I mean, you're fundamentally walking through a large drain tube. It's a large, very smooth concrete structure that has a series of water jets that look similar to maybe fire nozzles all along the one side of it that simply sprayed water along it, and then the inertia of the water carried it up and over your head. One of the things we added that I thought was really, really cool is right after the big door that opened, which we called the cartouche door, when the door opened, we let the pumps ramp up so you could see the water fold itself up onto the arch. One thing I saw more than once is we would test the emergency stop in the building, which would immediately stop the pumps. And if the vortex was running, it would fall into itself. It would collapse in. And if anybody was unfortunate to be out there, you'd get pretty wet. But the vortex was nothing more than a fountain that was just spraying around the edge of the tube. And you were walking on a suspended bridge over the aqueduct I mentioned earlier.
Yeah, it's another one of those elements in an attraction that you will never see anywhere else. I don't know another attraction anywhere in the world that has like a water tunnel vortex like that. And it's that first time you do it and it opens up everyone, like an audible gasp because it's so cool.
It is cool. And darn it, now that it's closed, I want to be one of those people that get stuck in the tunnel when the emergency stop happens. Like Chris and Lee always want to roll back on a roller coaster. I would want to be stuck in the water vortex.
Yeah. I'm not going to say I haven't been. Let's put it that way.
You know what, Michelle? I'm adding that to my list. It's rollback, velocicoaster, ET walk-off, and vortex tunnel getting splashed on.
Yeah. If I may, one of the rituals when you leave the building and you're no longer a part of the team, they let you stand on the walkway and ramp the whole thing down on you. They called it the 21 Water Jet Salute.
Nice.
Really?
Wow. Yeah.
And I was one of them.
How cool.
Because you imagine it had to ramp down every cycle because all of the pump pressure was then diverted out to the main attraction and all of the spinning fish and the waterfalls and the sprays and the water curtains were run off of the same pumps that had just done the vortex.
Yep. And that you wouldn't believe how warm that water is when it hits you.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I mean, you can feel the humidity when you walk through it. It's like, because my Tracy has glasses on, and I know we always come through that room, and she can't see a thing after it.
I mean, it's borderline hot water, especially if it's been a busy day.
It is, yeah. It warms up. It gets really warm in the pond, and with all the lights and the fire effects, it does get very warm.
Well, how warm are we talking? Very warm?
I would venture to say it's probably in the upper 80s, near 90. Water.
Wow.
It is very, the few times that I maybe went into the pond, it was very comfortably warm. The first time I was freaked out thinking it was going to be cold, and it was quite surprising. it's quite warm. He's right. The water is quite warm.
Strange, isn't it? I mean, seeing you were talking about the size of that building, again, we've talked about how much real estate that's going to give. Just the facade itself is huge. That entrance
footprint.
It's crazy. It's crazy to have an attraction in there now and walk. Like, how many people who've never been to Universal are going to walk into Lost Continent and be like, what is that? And then go, oh, you can't go on it, by the way. It's closed.
Unfortunately, yes. And it is a beautiful facade.
It really is. Oh,
yeah. Well, and now hearing about the underground and all of the investments that went into that building, I find it hard to believe they're just going to demolish it and start from scratch with something.
Things have happened in the past with attractions where there have been structural issues or who knows. I have absolutely no background into that.
Okay.
But there can be other reasons to close.
Yeah, because we speculated for the longest time that it closed when the parks closed due to COVID. And the fact that we got like 18 months down the line after the parks reopened that it still hadn't reopened, we kind of speculate, I don't think you'll see it reopen again. And then to our surprise, it did. And then, like we said earlier, to do that big refurb on it, for it to go down for a couple of months and then reopen again, you were like, oh, well, surely it's going to be open for quite some time now. And then just out of the blue, I've got like quite a few team member friends who work that attraction, and I started to see some sort of vague Facebook posts, and I'm like, what's going on? And then the next thing they've announced that it's closed was a bit of a shock, honestly.
Yep.
It happens. The powers that be do not share that information much internally for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
And so when closures happen, they're usually pretty abrupt.
Yeah.
Those bean counters.
Speaking from experience, sometimes timing's a factor. So like we were getting ready to build a haunted house inside the old Herkinzina building, and they were coming through doing measurements with fake productions to start putting the walls in. And literally as they were doing that, they were ordered to stop because they had gotten the order to demolish the building to start putting in transformers.
Wow.
Yeah,
it's crazy. I love delving into this stuff because as theme park fans, we don't, you know, we know bits and bobs because we've obviously got people we've made friends with over the years. But then to find like this in-depth stuff is stuff you just don't hear about. And it's absolutely fascinating.
It's all about numbers.
Unfortunately. Yep.
So Tony, we know that you helped map out the original Taylor run and you were a test Taylor. So tell us about that, because that sounds pretty fun.
Oh, I was the dumb 20-year-old kid at the time that was going to do it, I guess. Basically, Taylor, when he runs his route out in the show scenes, there was already some walking route out there from the previous attraction, although we did add on to it. We added some additional bridges and some additional places for him to be able to go to. He was in a very dangerous area between the water sprays and the curtains, the rain curtains and the gas effects and all that, and the fact he was interacting with that.
Yeah.
It was very, very critical that we knew where he was at any given moment to keep him safe. And so a choreography had to be worked out that allowed him to appear to be somewhat random. You know, it's all in the acting. You have to appear as though you're randomly running somewhere and interacting with the show. At the same time, obviously, it's very strictly marked out, and he had to hit safety buttons. He or she, I should say, because I know there were female
teachers. Yes.
They had to hit safety buttons throughout the run, and we had to figure out the run. Basically, nobody, it was not pre-choreographed in any script or anything what it was going to be. So we started out with it dry, and I actually nixed that fairly early on because it occurred to me if it was dry, I was going to fall 6 to 8 to 12 feet into a concrete pit with a bunch of jets and lights and pipes and valves in there, and I really didn't like that idea.
No.
Running in water isn't much safer. I know I'm not the only one to have fallen in, and you can get hurt falling in because, again, it's not just water. There's a lot in that water, and the few times that I misstepped or missed my mark or whatever or literally walked off the edge, I got bumped up a few times. Luckily, I never got seriously hurt. But there were many, many, many paths worked out, and you know where I needed to be at the right time for the right effects to work, and where I needed to hit safety buttons to let the show system know I made it to the clearance point for the next effect, because obviously the large dangerous ones couldn't go off until the system knew I was clear. So it was a lot of just running and working, and oh, by the way, we should probably work a script into this while we're at it. And that turned into, okay, let's make this natural. And then other people come in with other ideas, and we'd remap it and remove the buttons, or the buttons were too obvious and things like that. So it was a lot of fun. It was many, many weeks turning into months of running that path. And every time an executive would come in and want to see the progress, I'd have to run it again.
It's crazy because I think it's testament to how good it was then that as a guest, you never even consider, I've never considered that Taylor's in an area that obviously guests aren't allowed in a dangerous position. And it never occurs to you at that point that they are potentially in danger, and it's just part of the show. It's so well done.
It is. I mean, a water blast will knock you over, and that's one thing. But obviously a fire effect is going to do a lot more damage. And we went through a lot of very specific placements to the point I almost have, now that I've said all of this, I almost have to wonder if with current OSHA rules and whatnot, maybe that doesn't have something to do with the demise of the attraction.
Mm, okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I just noticed the last time I went on it, which was, it was probably spring this year. I did notice when Taylor was up, like in the final scene, climbing up on the rocks and stuff, I was paying attention to how precarious that must be. You know, yes, with the humidity in the room, and how is that stuff not slippery?
Yeah.
And I don't see any like safety harnesses or anything on the actor. So how is she up there not falling? Like, I was paying attention to all that because I've seen it so many times. So yeah, it did look like a pretty treacherous job if you break it down like that.
It certainly was interesting. I mean, towards the end, I just had it down and I got kind of lazy about it. And I certainly had several tailors that we showed it to. I remember we had a few in the beginning that just flat out didn't want to do it.
Yeah, I can imagine. Because like you say, it's a wet environment. So climbing up on things, yeah, it would make a lot of sense then if that's part of the reason, that just the safety of the team members.
It's certainly possible, and I don't know what – I had nothing to do with their hiring or what, if they received any extra, you know, pay or training or anything to do that. That I have no idea, but I know I didn't. But it not only that, but it's wet and it's re-wet by the various actions, and there are lights flashing around you and things black out and the fire flashes, so – It's not like you're just able to focus on it. You really have to pay close attention to what you're doing. And if you miss a mark between you and the technical director that's watching the show, it's possible that they can readjust effects and move the show on, other words. But generally, the design was if you missed a mark, you're going to shut down the show.
Wow.
Wow.
So I'm sure working on an attraction of this scale was a blast, and we're sure that you have many stories to tell, but are there any quick ones you could share with us to wrap up our podcast?
I remember one of my favorites, and this was just a very obscure little thing, but it's a fun little bit of trivia. In the scene just before the cartouche door, just before the water vortex, that originally was a scene that was made up to look like the final scene when the room falls back in.
Yes.
And we heavily remodeled that. And one of the things we had to do is fill these large pits that were originally to simulate the water pits that were out in the show scene. And we had to dump in concrete. Now, I remember we were very concerned because the cement that we were pouring into there was going to be, you know, many feet thick, you know, eight feet thick or so of cement, and it had to dry very quickly. And the cement company assured us that, oh, no, this is ultra-fast drying cement. Everything will be fine. What they didn't bother to mention to us is ultra-fast drying cement makes a lot of heat. I mean, a lot of heat. And that's how it does. It's a chemical reaction. And we all went home after it got poured in there, didn't think about it until we got a call from security in the fire department that we'd set off the alarms and the sprinklers in that scene because it had gotten so hot in there that these sprinklers that had melted. Fire sprinklers are set off by melting a little wax seal. And it had set off the sprinklers in that scene.
Wow.
Oh, my goodness.
That was our one little bit of fun. And the other trivia point that we discovered is when the room that comes in at the end doesn't make it and we had to reset it, it went through this whole reset function that it did where it would go up and down and test its limits and check itself. We discovered that that was the exact length of Come Sail Away. So we Come Sail Away over the PA while we reset, we knew how long we had left. That's
awesome. Michael, you need to talk to Tony about writing a book. Michael has written a book about him working at the Mummy and the stories from there. I think a book of your experiences working on some of the attractions at Universal would be amazing.
Oh, definitely. I love that idea.
I've got some stories, believe me. I will take tours of friends out through Islands of Adventure, give them all the background for building that place.
Awesome.
Wow.
Tony, it has been an absolute pleasure to have you on. I feel like if you're willing, this will not be the first time we will have you on.
I would love to come back. I love to regale my stories of Universal. It's a fine company with many amazing engineers and designers, and they've done some amazing stuff.
Yes. I mean, it's one of the things when we started this podcast 12 years ago, one of my desires was to get those stories out there that people don't know. I've said before, everybody knows the story of Pirates of the Caribbean or the Jungle Cruise or It's a Small World or Haunted Mansion. But those stories about Universal, people don't know. And we've had so many people on over the time delving into the stories of Jaws and Kong and Back to the Future and stuff. And the more of those stories we can get out there, the more... Like I always said, I made this podcast for me because what I wanted to hear about, and those stories are amazing. And at some point, those stories aren't going to be there anymore. So it's like putting them down in this podcast for other people to enjoy as well.
Well, I had a fine time working as a technician there also. And I know I heard Chris make the comment, one of his bucket lists would be to walk off of ET. And I can tell you some wonderful stories working on ET over the years.
Oh, man.
Yes.
Yeah, ET is... I'm pretty sure E.T. is a haunted attraction, but that's a whole other story.
Interesting. That's a whole other podcast we definitely have to do.
Oh, yes. And Tracy needs to be
another,
here for that.
Another Rush of Fear episode.
Yeah. There you go.
Cool. Right. Well, that is, of course, going to wrap up this episode of the podcast. I hope you've enjoyed kind of regaling our stories and Tony's stories about Poseidon's Fury. But, of course, we are going to wrap up this week's episode with another Universal Is. And this week's comes from our very special guest, Tony. But don't forget, we'd like to get you involved. So just let us know what you think Universal Is in three words or less and send them to us at podcast@uorpodcast.com. But for now, Tony, it is over to you.
Leading on what I said a few moments ago, Universal is groundbreaking.
Very nice. Cool. All right, everyone. See you next week.
That was another episode of the unofficial Universal Orlando podcast, the best and only podcast about Universal Orlando on the island. Check us out on social media, on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and Pinterest. Just search UUO Podcast. For all the podcasts, news, and articles, check out our blog at UUOpodcast.com. Contact us at podcast@UUOpodcast.com. Join the Producers Club by emailing us at UUOPproducers@gmail.com. Listen and subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, and everywhere else podcasts are found. Check out our friends, the Theme Park Duo, for all your other theme park news, and email Michelle at portkeyvacations.net to book your next trip. So until next time, this is Amity 6, call off the Marines, we're coming home.
Dearly beloved, we are here, the members of the unofficial Universal Orlando podcast, to pay our respects to the sadly departed Lost Continent attraction, Poseidon's Fury. We just wanted to say a few words of condolence about the attraction. Michelle, would you like to speak first, please?
Okay, this is so, so hard for me, because the attraction will be sorely missed by my family. My first memory of it was taking my family through. My Krissa was only about 4 years old, and she had a crush on Taylor and didn't stop talking about Taylor for probably 2 years after that. Taylor, you will be sorely missed. I will miss your water vortex the most because I had so much fun walking through it. I'm so sad. Hopefully we see the water vortex in a different attraction someday.
Thank you, Michelle. Beautiful words. Chris, would you please step up to the podium?
Yes, of course. Wow, Poseidon, gone. Gone too soon, some may say. Not soon enough, some others may say, but we don't listen to those people. I remember first going to this attraction when the park first opened up during a preview, and I was just blown away. I was completely blown away. There was an old man that took us around. It was amazing. We transport to different places. I mean, the city of Atlantis instead of a theme park. It's amazing. And as Michelle said, we will miss that water vortex. I mean, every time I went through it, I got just a little wet. Sometimes wetter than others. Sometimes not so wet. The wetness doesn't matter here. What matters is the vortex was amazing. It was a modern marvel into the world of Atlantis. So I will pour one out for you. And I may not be as wet as I used to be, but Poseidon, Fury, we will miss you.
Thank you, Christopher. Tracy, if you would like to say your piece, please.
This is so difficult and so unexpected. And what can I say about Poseidon's Fury that no one else has said? I don't know.
I'm crying so much. She is lost for words. She's so sad.
Has anybody got a tissue?
Thank you, Tracy. Thank you. Poseidon, as you can see, you will be sadly missed. From your amazing facade to your epic cheesiness and the amazing water vortex tunnel. And your superb actors, you will be forever in our thoughts. Peace be with you. Kebobs to kebobs, gyro to gyro.